You are listening to the 80s Slasher Librarian. Keep listening, or I'll kill you.
There's a lover in the story, but the story's still the same. There's a lullaby for suffering and a paradox to blame. But it's written in the scriptures and it's not some idle claim. I didn't know I had permission to murder and to maim. You want it darker? We kill the flame.
Chapter 15. With nowhere else to go in this mainly virtual world, Free and Sky headed back to the camp. They did not talk as they ran because neither had a plan. At the moment, they were operating purely on the instinct to flee. As they hit the main road, still running, Free said, "We have to be careful. Viper isn't Jason, but he's dangerous in his own way." Sky, puffing, pointed ahead. "I don't think he'll be a danger to us." They saw his remains and those of his gang as they reached the cabins. Sky doubled over and held her stomach. "I'd vomit," she said, "if I had anything in my stomach today." "Well, let's head to the lab. At least we have equipment there. Maybe we can think of something." "All right, but wait just a second," she said, seeing the open door to the cabin where they'd been held captive. "I want to check on Herbert." But when Sky looked in the doorway, instead of entering, she backed out. This time she got the dry heaves. "Come on," Free said, pulling her away, catching a glimpse of who and what was inside that cabin. "We can't waste any time. He'll be on us soon." Inside the lab, they found that somehow most of the equipment was still intact. "I guess they didn't know what to do with it, or even how to destroy it," Free said, amazed. "Major Tom. Come in, Major Tom." "Nothing." "God damn it, where is he?" "Let's just hope he's not controlling Jason," Sky said. "But it sure looks like he is, or the original AI is, or maybe both of them are. I wish we knew for sure, Free." They looked through the glass door of the biolab at the same time and saw the same thing, and jolted. "What the fuck?" Free said. The holographic image that Herbert and Anyar created was now a body, covered with skin, and beneath that muscle and bone. It was a very familiar body, the body of Jason. Tentatively, Free went inside first. He walked around the platform. Sky went to her computer, typing away madly. "I think I've got it," she said. "Anyar and Herbert were supposed to program a bioarm from DNA from the bank. It looks like they did the whole body." "But they weren't supposed to," Free said, remembering that he had instructed them to stick to the arm. "Remember when Anyar came in here with that Viper guy? Maybe she saw a chance to do something that might help." "By building another Jason?" "She likely didn't know that this model was based on him. It was the computer model, remember? Only you and I knew it resembled my father's model. And only a few of us had ever seen Jason face to face. Look, she probably figured that if she could complete the biological part of the cyborg, maybe it could be animated to help us." "How do we do that?" Free said. "That's our project. It's supposed to take us 6 months, not 6 days, let alone 6 goddamn minutes. Sky left her console and entered the biolab. "I wish I knew more about this computer." "What about you?" "Hell, I wish I knew anything about this equipment," Free said. "Here, let me at those panels. I studied this stuff a little." "Finish him off," Free said. "Can you do that? Is he close enough to being finished?" "I think so. The body looks complete. Hold on. I've got my father's program in the computer. Well, not his, but one I created based on everything he said on the cubes. I haven't tested it yet, but..." "Can we program the cyborg to fight for us?" Free asked, cutting to the chase. "Can and will. If I can help it. Just do it. See if you can bring this creature to life." Sky spent several minutes keying in the code she had created that would infuse the form in the biolab with life. The minute she hit send, the being on the platform began to alter. Its face took on features, and its body definition became more detailed. It looked more and more like Jason with every passing second. And then a most astonishing thing happened. You've done a marvelous job. I'm very happy with this version. Free and Sky looked at each other, and Free said, Major Tom, it is I. Where have you been? Free asked tentatively. Free, don't be so distressful, the AI chided him. Why, I've been waiting here for you to finish the cyborg. Sky and Free looked at each other. Oh, it's all very simple, really. I was programmed to participate in your project by Mr. Mansfield. The project reached the stage where the cyborg was about to be infused with life. This is where I come in. So you've been waiting here until we reached a certain stage of the project? Is that what I'm hearing? Free asked, slowly and carefully. That's correct. And now that we've reached it, you can direct the cyborg? Yes. Wait, Sky said. Who's running Jason? No one is running Jason. He runs himself. But your original AI program, the first Major Tom, wasn't that program running Jason? I suppose so. And perhaps some fragments of programming are still within Jason from my predecessor. I have no way of knowing that. I have my own mission. I am the new improved Major Tom. My programming takes precedence. But if there are fragments of programming in Jason from the original Major Tom, Free said, then that must mean that Jason is the one that was sent off this moon by JJ and Amanda 20 years ago, into a black hole, they said. Well, as far as my understanding goes, yes, that was their intention. And I believe Jason did manage to leave here for a time and go elsewhere. What do you mean, leave here for a time? Sky asked. Are you saying he was brought back? Of course. He and my predecessor were inseparable. I believe he was brought back here before the original Major Tom was reprogrammed by the military. Part of this new program was to keep Jason in storage, as it were, until needed. Sky and Free just stared at each other. Okay, this is too weird, Sky said to Free. Huh, I agree, he said, and we don't have the luxury of time to explore this existential dilemma right this moment. Knowing that Jason is controlled by the original AI and that he was brought back is enough to know. And it doesn't really matter, does it? We've got to get this cyborg fully functional. Maybe with your father's program. Can you get the cyborg fully functional, Major Tom? I can. I will complete the program that the late Miss Barnes and Mr. Simpson began and amalgamate it with Dr. Castillo's reanimation program. I do need a bit of help, though. I require a verbal or manual command to incorporate the program. The password is Medieval. I fear the voice recognition software will not accept my voice, nor the voice patterns of anyone else. Although, of course, you are the only two living beings left. Free and Sky looked at each other again. Just the two of us? Nobody else? Sky said. Well, there is Jason. And with a little help, there will be another Jason, a superior version. The program Medieval will recognize your voice, Free. You are, after all, the project leader, and have the authority to supersede any program. Another Jason? Sky said. I hope we're doing the right thing. Free said aloud. Open program, Medieval, and incorporate the software into the cyborg. Done. Sky and Free looked at the being they had created. I can't believe it, but he looks exactly like Jason, Sky said. Suddenly she looked down. I hope this isn't a mistake. My father did everything in triplicate, including splitting my mother's egg into three parts so she would give birth to triplets. He reanimated Jason when he pulled him out of the black hole, and he built the software that built the Jason that was thrust off this moon, the one who was buried under the military complex. This might be the third Jason to come out of Moon Complex, and if I read my father's words correctly, each one should be an improvement. This one will be the most powerful.
Jason to the third power.
Free said somberly. He looked at Sky. We have no choice. Let's just hope we can control this one. To the cyborg, he said, step off. Jason the Third turned its head and said in Major Tom's voice, I'd be delighted to, Mr. Jefferson. God, Sky said, this one even talks? Not exactly, Miss Fellows. You might notice his lips do not move. I could correct that with time. But I gather that right now there are other priorities, not to mention this mask over his face. With that, the cyborg Jason took a step off the platform, onto the floor. The being didn't have the refinement of movement that it should, nor did it have the ease and rapidity of response. But Free knew that it was all they were going to get right now, and if this was a more powerful Jason, they would need to control it. As if reading his mind, Major Tom said, I can iron out the bugs as we go. And of course, your wish is our command. Our? Sky said. MT, Free asked, are you able to operate outside the cyborg? For short periods, yes, as needed. I can still maintain the basic operations of the moon complex automatically, such as supporting life, sending and receiving communications to and from. Okay, that's what we want. We need to send a communication. To whom? To Jackson Mansfield. But he's so far away, Sky said. Why not to Earth too? I think JJ was right. They're not going to help us. Remember what happened to Joe, the shuttle pilot? Yes, but that was an accident. Sky, wake up. This is a bigger problem than just a shuttle accident, and a computer malfunction, and a serial killer that wants to destroy the entire universe. We're dealing with things that the government on Earth 2 is at best trying to repress, and at worst trying to revive. And we're in the way of that repression or reconstruction. I've been thinking about it, and I get the feeling that it wasn't just chance that Earth 2 sold Jackson this moon. And I'm wondering if all this was a setup. How do you mean? I mean, they had the records from the pod my mother escaped in, including her medical records. If we could get them, so could they. They knew she had a child, and they likely knew where she ended up. And as for you, I can't believe they wouldn't have known who your father was. Sky paused a second before looking up at Free. You think they put us together? Manipulated us in some way to work on this project together? Maybe even adjusted our test scores? It sounds paranoid, but I'm beginning to get really paranoid. I think we have to consider it. Do you trust that Jackson wasn't part of this? Sky, I've known him all my life, and maybe he's known all about you and me. He's a powerful man. Maybe he had something to do with this. Free was mortified by the idea, but he had to consider it. I can't say anything for sure, Sky, but I know that Jackson was there for my mother, and for me. I believe he'll help me, us. I say it's our best shot. She was silent, just staring at him, looking as frightened and confused as he felt himself. Free wasn't sure if she understood all that was going on inside of him, but from all that Free had seen and heard, it appeared to him right now as if his entire life had been lived to reach this point. He didn't know if Jackson had been a part of a large conspiracy which had to do with recouping Castillo's work, but of everyone in the universe, it was Jackson Mansfield that he still trusted, and they had to trust somebody. Major Tom sent an SOS to Jackson Mansfield. Done. Can you sense Jason too on this godforsaken moon? I can. Where is he now? Jason, too, is entering the road leading to the camp. Good God! Sky cried. Okay, we're going out the back door, all three of us, Free said. Let's go. But what's the plan? Sky asked. Free didn't answer her, just gave her a warning with his eyes. As they headed out the back with Free in the lead, Sky rushed to catch up to him. The cyborg that was Jason the Third, controlled by the AI Major Tom, the second, was several steps behind, its motor skills improving by the second. Why won't you say what you've got in mind? Skye said softly. Free put his arm around her and pulled her close, kissing her ear so he could whisper. Because I'm not sure if or how MT is linked with the original Major Tom. We've got to be careful. He led them around the back of the cabins and down a path that would get them back to the dirt road quickly. We're headed to the military complex, the AI said. Free said nothing. Skye also said nothing. The cyborg that was Jason III said nothing. But Major Tom started to sing softly. Chapter 16. Where's Jason 2 now? Free asked MT. Following, approximately half a kilometer behind us. Oh my god, Skye cried. We can't move fast enough. Just keep going, Free said. We're almost there. I assume we are headed to the complex, the AI said again. But Free didn't take the bait. He did notice, though, that the kinks had been worked out of Jason III's body. His movements were easier, and he now kept pace with Free and Skye. The five-sided building came into view, and Free put on a burst of speed. He raced around the structure to the edge of the huge dirt mound. Stop! He called behind him. Skye doubled over, gasping where she stood. Jason III was, of course, not winded, simply waiting for instructions. From here, Free was unnerved by the eerie resemblance to Jason II. Even the red eyes were the same. Major Tom, come with me. Skye, wait here until you hear from me. Skye watched Free move around the building further, past the start of the mound which he climbed. Then he was out of sight. Jason III followed him until he too was out of sight. Skye looked around in a panic. She didn't know what Free's plan was. She saw the sense in keeping info from the AI, but why from her? Why did he want her here as bait? Jason, too, didn't care about girls. He didn't care about anything, just the blood and guts he produced as he murdered everyone in his path. Suddenly, she saw Jason appearing along the path over the rise. The monster her father had been responsible for creating was coming along the path, coming toward her. Every cell in her body screamed, "Run!" From behind her somewhere, she heard Free yell, "Wait, Skye! Don't move yet! Just stay there!" She glanced behind her but couldn't see him. He must not realize how close Jason was to her, or he wouldn't be saying that. He was close enough that she could see the light glinting off the blue-gray metal of his machete, the ripple of muscles like steel where his skin was exposed, the burning hatred in those impossibly laser-red eyes. As she stared into them, she felt that he knew who she was, that he knew, if not by intellect, then by instinct. That she was the daughter of the man who had manipulated him, who he had killed, just as he would kill her. Skye tried to calm herself, tried to be logical. She struggled to think clearly, even though she had begun to hyperventilate. That couldn't be. It made no sense that he could know who she was. But then she realized that Jason II was run by the original AI, wasn't he? Or maybe not. Maybe he's run by the duplicate AI. Maybe it's a setup. But either way, he has a memory and was maybe sophisticated enough to identify DNA. He knows who my father was, she realized. The original Major Tom most likely had Castillo's DNA and probably passed it on to the new AI. And Jason, too, knew her father was the man he had murdered by driving 3 mirror fragments into his artificial eye, slicing open his brain mass, and now he wanted to kill Skye. Not even because she was Castillo's daughter, just because she existed, and because she was alive. Panic swelled up in her like a river overrunning its banks. She couldn't control herself. Skye turned and ran. No, Skye, wait! She heard Free yelling, but she couldn't. Her body would not allow her to stand there as this demon stalked her. Just like in her nightmares. But this was real. Not imaginary. Not virtual. That huge knife had her name on the blade. She ran in the direction Free had gone and could feel Jason closing in on her. Panic, she twisted her head around to look behind, to make sure he wasn't about to snatch her. and lost her footing just as she reached the mound. Her body tumbled and fell down 9 stories into the corpse-ridden gully below. Surrounding her were bodies, many bodies, cut and bloody and stinking, and she cried out in fear and disgust. Dirt fell in with her, causing a mini landslide. Sky quickly became covered in earth, like a quick burial with the already dead, drowning out her screams. Bloody mud clotted her eyes, filling her nose and mouth, her ears, cutting off the outside world entirely. Now she shrieked, the sound low in her throat, having no way to get out and nowhere to go. Hysterically, she clawed her way up through the soil, fighting for air, her hands touching cold as marble body parts slick with blood that make her shriek all the more. And when her head finally surfaced, she tried her best to get as much air as she could. She rubbed the dirt out of her eyes, off of her face, coughed it out of her lungs, and breathed it out from her nostrils. She saw a corpse lying close by, its dead eyes staring into hers as if it were saying, "Hello, glad you could join me." She tore her eyes away and looked up. 9 levels above, Malevolent stared down at her. He crouched down, preparing to leap into the hole. Anything to get at her and to tear her apart. The scream coming out of her was long and loud, and she could not, for anything, have stopped it. "Now, Major Tom, get out there and distract him." Free ran ahead even as he gave the order, hoping that he himself could distract Jason while waiting for the newer version to get in there and help him out. All this had gone so wrong. He should have told Sky what he wanted to do, but he was so used to them being in sync mentally, and he hadn't wanted to spill his plan to Major Tom, just to be on the safe side, and now it was all screwed up. Sky was supposed to have stayed there until he called her. Then she would have run around the building, avoiding the hole, and the two of them would have been behind Jason 3, which he would have sent into battle with Number 2, with instructions to shove him into the hole. They could have buried him and gotten the hell out of here. But now it was all a mess. Now he didn't know what to do. The only thing he was sure of was that he had to get Sky out of that grave she had fallen into, and get Jason 2 into it. "Over here!" he yelled, waving his arms until Jason 2 looked his way. Jason the 3rd finally caught up and stepped out into the open, where Jason 2 could see his mirror image, as well as see Free. The two Jasons stared at each other with hate-streaked eyes. Then Jason 2 snapped his head to look at Free, who wondered briefly about this three-way DNA triangle, and how odd it was for all of them. "Keep him away from the hole!" Free said. Jason 3 advanced. Meanwhile, Free yelled down at Sky. "Try to climb up!" "I'm trying!" she yelled back. "The soil is too loose, too slippery. I need a rope!" "A rope! A rope!" Free searched for the makeshift rope they had used to get down from the top floor. He saw it, then suddenly remembered that it hadn't been long enough to begin with, and that he'd cut it so the rope was even shorter than before. Even if he ripped the shirt off his back and used his pants to extend it, the rope would not be long enough. "You have to go through the inside," he yelled. "I'll come up and get you as you come up." Sky trudged through the loose dirt and reached the window. She climbed in as fast as she could and hurried to the stairway. Free's intention was to head around the building to the entrance, but he quickly realized that he was still between the two Jasons. He realized something else as well. They were not facing off against each other, but were both staring at him, and he didn't like the way they were looking. It was like irrational rage in duplicate. Free kept staring back and forth between them. One had a machete, one did not. Otherwise, they were identical. Until suddenly, as one unit, they both began walking very fast in his direction. "What the hell is going on?" he screamed. "Major Tom! Major Tom! Get Jason 3 to attack Jason 2! Free said, running as fast as he could.
"Oh, but I can't do that," MT said.
"Why the hell not?" Free ran away from the mound of dirt, widening the distance a bit between himself and both of the Jasons.
"Isn't it obvious? They share the same DNA. They can't turn on one another. It would be like attacking oneself. It's the DNA, you see. I'm programmed with the DNA. Programmed toward the DNA. Programmed to support the strongest DNA. And they are equally matched.
What the hell are you talking about? Free yelled. He was in a full run now. Both giants close on his heels. He had to do something to escape. But he couldn't leave Sky. He didn't know whether to run back to the camp and lead them away from Sky, or to enter the building and get her. If these two decided to split up and one headed for Sky, she was finished. Instinct took over and he raced into the entrance of the building and headed for the stairwell and down. He remembered the weapons floor. JJ had said that weapons wouldn't kill Jason, but they might slow them down, and that would give him and Sky at least some time. He tore down the steps, slamming the few doors that remained on hinges behind him, even though he knew they would not hold them back but for a second. But a second here, another there, it could add up to survival. At the lounge, he was confronted with bodies littering the floor and the walls painted with blood. He tried not to focus on the horror of it. Mixed with the stench of blood and decay was another smell, alcohol, and when he noticed the bottles of booze, he got an idea. He grabbed a few bottles and the flamethrower and raced to the next doorway. The two Jasons were already in the lounge. As Free reached the doorway, he lifted his arms above his head and threw all the bottles a couple of steps ahead of him. As he leapt over the broken glass, he ignited the alcohol. It caught instantly and spread quickly. The flames weren't that high, and it wouldn't last long once the alcohol burned off, but it might be high enough to keep the two Jasons from passing. He didn't wait to find out. He was already down the next flight and slamming that door behind him too. Free and Sky met at the second laboratory down, one floor up from the munitions floor.
"There are bodies everywhere," she cried.
Without a word, he grabbed her arm and turned her around, pulling her across the slippery floor to the next doorway. Only when they reached the floor with the weapons did they dare to speak to one another.
What happened? Sky asked.
They're the same, Free said. The two of them are identical and the two MTs are running them, I think.
But that can't be. The one we built has the DNA, the memories of all of us, all but you.
And I think that doesn't matter much. I think what we put into the cyborg didn't make a dent because, frankly, it was already programmed in some way.
By who?
I can't tell you that because I don't know. All I know for sure is that those two are identical. I see it and I can feel it in every cell of my body. Free grabbed up a couple of laser guns and what he thought were laser clips, plus a long gun that might pack a wallop, shoving as much ammo as he could into the pockets and waistband of his pants. He didn't even know if he could figure out how to reload. "Here, take these," he said, handing her a dozen weapons, and she stored them the same way as he had.
"These guys had guns," she said, nodding at the bodies surrounding them. "It obviously didn't help."
Free knew she was right, but he had to do something.
"It's my fault," Sky cried, holding her head. "I shouldn't have used my father's programs. I'm just like him. I created another Jason."
They heard movement on the stairs. "They're coming," Free said, and with hand gestures he indicated to Sky that she should stay on one side of the room and he would be on the other. He wanted to split up the two Jasons. He hoped that with the weapons they could force them down into the basement floor, and he hoped he conveyed some of that to Sky. The fire in the lounge had slowed them. That was a good sign. Something to remember. Jason 2 and Jason 3 entered the doorway almost side by side. The only way Free could tell the difference was that one had a machete and the other did not. Free caught Sky's eye. He grabbed his own arm and slapped the skin there and at his neck, indicating that she should aim for flesh. Sky felt almost paralyzed with fear. She did not know if she could even fire a laser. Every part of her wanted to run screaming down to the next level. But her dreams came to mind at that moment, and she knew that if she ran away, she would not survive. The two Jasons split up, one going for Free, one for Sky. Free fired lasers with both hands,
and Sky did the same. The power of the beam stopped both Jasons. They stood quivering as the lasers cut into the armor and seared their flesh. Free began moving along the wall to the doorway that led up, and on the other side of the room, Sky did the same. As one laser died, he grabbed another, training it on Jason 2. Sky did the same with Jason 3, not stopping to reload, and just going to the next gun. They reached the doorway, and Free nodded for her to go first. She turned and ran with Free on her heels, but Jason 3 was on his heels, followed by Jason 2. They managed to make their way across the laboratory, using up another four lasers apiece.
"We're gonna have to reload," Sky cried.
"On the way up," Free yelled back. Free noticed that both Jasons were not stunned as long as they had been the first time. He wondered if they were adapting as they went, if the programming was altering. Up they went through the other lab, the sleeping quarters, and continued on until they reached the lounge.
"Oh my God!"
Sky screamed at the carnage before her. She was bent over, trying to catch her breath, and Free was breathing hard as well.
"Give me all your weapons. I'll hold them off," Free cried. "Get all the booze bottles you can and break them at the other stairwell. Do it fast!"
While he yelled, he fired down into the descending stairwell. They had just come up, hitting Jason 2, who was now in the lead. His massive presence kept the other Jason from passing him.
I've got at least 3 dozen, Sky called to him.
Free heard her breaking the glass. He knew that while the two Jasons didn't seem to have broken out in a sweat, his own stamina was waning, and he suspected Sky was more than exhausted. He snatched the flamethrower, turned and ran across the room, the two Jasons pounding up the rest of the steps and across the floor after him. Once more, he leapt over the bottles, igniting them on the way. The alcohol caught instantly, like a small blast. But this time, a massive hand grabbed Free's shirt, and he felt himself being pulled back.
"Look out!"
Sky called, reaching for him at the same moment, pulling him forward as the shirt ripped off of his back. The fire licked at his legs, searing the fabric of his pants as it rose. The fire somehow caused Jason's grip to loosen, allowing Free to dash towards Sky and the stairway. They ran up the last flight of stairs, through the main floor, and out the door into the air. Suddenly, the earth trembled beneath them. They stopped for a moment, instinctively glancing up.
"Oh my God, the sling is moving," Sky said.
The sling was scraping along the dome, creating new fissures at the outermost layer.
"Come on,"
Free said, pulling her toward the road. With the last of their energy, they managed to get to the camp, and reading each other's minds, they silently headed to the lab.
Okay, this has been chapters 15 and 16 of Jason X to the Third Power. And I almost put this into the upload tonight, but whenever Free said, "Jason to the Third Power," I was so going to put this little clip in there right after he said, "Jason to the Third Power."
He said it!
But I wasn't sure how many of you guys would get the reference, and I didn't want to, you know, mess up the audiobook, the seriousness of it and everything. But there you go. You know, you can imagine anybody who has seen Family Guy or knows that reference was probably thinking that whenever Free said the words Jason to the Third Power. Anyways, guys, I'm curious to know what you guys think of Major Tom turning on him, which I've suspected from the get-go. What do you think of another Jason? And, what do you think of the book as a whole so far? After reading this one, I'm really looking forward to reading Death Moon, which is a prequel to this book, and is the story of Dr. Castillo and how the original Jason became Jason 2, or whatever's going on now. But I'm really glad that I skipped that book and did this one first, because it's going to be fun reading that as a prequel, filling in these holes and not doing them exactly in order. I think it's going to be pretty interesting. I don't think it's going to ruin anything. It's still going to be full of surprises and everything. So I'm looking forward to that. And I'm also looking forward to the next upload, which will be the conclusion of Jason X to the Third Power. So I'll be back very soon with the conclusion of this book. Can't wait to see how it all ends. Let me know what you guys think in the comments, what your predictions are, what you thought of tonight's upload.
and what you hope to see in the final conclusion upload of Jason X to the Third Power. Until then, this has been your friendly neighborhood 80s slasher librarian saying, thanks for listening, and this has been Jason X to the Third Power.
He said it!
I didn't know I had permission to murder and to maim. You want it darker? We kill the flame.